And now, another exciting episode in the adventures of Outdoor Journal Radio.
Well, hello, everybody. Thank you for joining us once again. I'm Angelo Viola. He is Peter Bowman.
Hi, Angelo.
Hello, Peter.
Good morning.
We are coming to you live, I guess. Live to tape would be a good way to
live to
describe.
Tape.
Live to tape. You know what that means?
No, they used to say that on the TV sometimes,
yeah,
right?
Because no editing.
Yeah.
Like for example, I'll give you an example. There's programs now that go live to tape. The Academy Awards are live to tape. The Geminis are live to tape. Country Music Awards are live to
tape.
You think
we're going to get an Academy Award for this anytime in the near future?
Give me a hell yeah!
Hell, you baby, you got that right.
Okay.
Coming to you live from the Toronto Sportsmen Show, we will actually be producing three or four episodes this week. We'll be here all week long. We have been here all week long. For those of you watching now, obviously it's in the past.
Yeah. Just us? We're three, but then we have the Ugly Pike guys, we have Eating Wild guys, we got Diaries of a Lodge Owner. Is Jerry going to be doing any from here at all?
I believe he is too. Yeah. So Dino knows.
He's been doing them.
Light them up.
So you're going to hear all kinds of noise in the background. You'll hear geese occasionally flying right over top of the booth. Thank you. And our good friend Leo Stakos, Fish TV.
Speaking of a goose, there's a turkey.
He's going to be trying to outdo us here. Probably going to start in about a half hour into this show.
When he gets going, he gets her going good, doesn't he? His speakers are louder than ours.
Yeah, his is bigger than ours, for sure.
Yeah, that's what just ask him. He'll tell you that one.
So we'll try and talk over him. So if you hear it in the background, don't get distracted. What a program we have got for you today. I cannot divulge our special guest is.
You see, the thing is if they look at the YouTube or if they look at the Spotify description, I'm pretty sure we're going to have that in there unless we just write special guest.
Oh, we might.
Because you kind of got to put it in
there.
Are we
even allowed to do that?
Yeah, I'll probably have to do that.
Yeah, we'll need some audience listeners, won't we, on that one?
People will know.
That's okay. We won't reveal it yet. How's that?
No, because I like surprising myself. So when I say we can't divulge, I'm even talking to myself. We can't divulge until we bring him onto the show, which will be very, very short.
It's going to be huge.
Huge.
Biggest guest ever for us, I would say. Is it?
I would say so. Although, you know, in all fairness, I had him on the old radio show before.
But he
wasn't who he is now. So that's right. All right. So anyways,
that's a good hint.
Enough to say on that one. It's going to be huge. along with the I also want to remind folks that we've got the store open, not only open online, but the store is open here at the Toronto Sportsman Show.
Come on now.
All the wonderful paraphernalia that has our brand on it is being sold as we speak.
So if you were at the Sportsman Show, because this is going to be after the Sportsman Show, I'm assuming, and you bought stuff from our store, thank you very much for buying from the store.
There it is right there.
Shop.fishingcanada.com on the web, but it's also live here. So
how you doing? Good looking. There's people. The thing is, people are wandering around here, and we're saluting and saying hello to folks as they walk by. Come on in. Anybody standing out there, you come on in and have a seat. We're giving something away for folks who are going to be sitting and joining us live.
Come on now.
Exactly.
There you go.
I like that.
So we'll be distracted throughout this program for sure.
That's okay.
Fine.
We have our lovely guests sitting into this.
If you're not here at the show and you still want to get some of this lovely merchandise, you can go to the shop. .fishingcanada.com. That's shop.fishingcanada.com. Although if you buy it here, of course, you save on all those nasty shipping charges that people don't seem to like.
Come on now.
You know, I mean, when I'm ordering is Amazon and it says free shipping, it's a nice incentive, you know what I mean?
And you take advantage of it.
Well,
why wouldn't you?
What the hell, right? It's not free because you got to join them at $10, $20 a month.
Oh, there is that.
You pay that shipping twice or three times over. Anyways,
get listener good TV feedback.
Listener feedback comes listener to us feedback. From Brendan Dodge via YouTube. What is the model of boat with Princecraft do you use? What model do we use? I looked them up and I did not see anything close. I'm not sure. That's obviously in the Princecraft site you would see it.
So he's Brendan. Referring to FNC1.
Oh.
Clearly, FNC1.
Oh.
That's what he's saying.
I'm getting you now.
He's saying, I haven't seen anything even close to that at a Prince Craft dealership.
Okay. Right.
And he would be right.
These two boats, that if you're watching on YouTube, the two boats behind us are actually the same model. They are the 200 Expedition. So we normally run a 200 Expedition, but FNC1 is Angelo's creation of a modified version of the boat he wanted to do. The boat that we're running right now is a 200 Expedition with a 250 Merc Pro XS on it, a Garmin Kraken this year. We're going to run a Garmin Kraken off the front, which is we're really looking forward to, versus the Force, which is a great another great motor, but this Kraken I think is going to be even better for us. You know, fully Garmined up, power poles in the back, you name it, but it's a great boat. It's a nice full-sized Prince Craft boat. You know.
So to answer your question, Brendan, no, you cannot purchase FNC1 from a dealership, but as Pete said, get yourself a wonderful Expedition 200, which is the base platform.
And you can still buy the exact one.
I was just about to say, our boat that we used last year is still for sale as we speak right now,
but
to
not
JMB.
Not FNC1, no. Not to be confused with that boat.
It's a boat we used last year. Like our main
point.
Boat.
Good point. Where can they find out more information about that, by the way?
JB Marine.
JB Marine.
Yeah, Rob.
JMB? Or is it JB?
It's
JMB.
JMB Marine.
They're up in Timmins. You'll see they have a place in Timmins and Sudbury. It's on their site.
And they have our boat from last year.
Our boat from last year. Lots of pictures that we took. You could have our boat. And it's a pretty good price, I'll tell you. For a rigged boat like that, that's worth a lot of money brand new. You get a nice discount from there. So
there you go. Hopefully we answered your question, Brendan. And thank you for submitting that via YouTube. That's different, isn't it?
That's different, yeah.
We like that.
Yeah.
We like that.
We do like
from
that.
Everywhere.
It's good for the algorithm.
Where would they normally ask these questions?
They normally email me, info. But we're getting a lot of people on YouTube. It's good for the algorithm.
Algorithms, yes.
Yeah, yeah.
I can't even spell that.
We need more algorithms in our life.
Can we make that simpler? Just algos? We'll just say algos.
Absolutely.
Algos anywhere he wants. There you go.
He does that too. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, moving on from the listener feedback, Podcast Network. By the way, we failed to mention, we are here at the Toronto Sportsman Show because we're promoting the Outdoor Journal Radio Podcast Network. And if you if you see this booth, then you will see it
by
now.
Pretty impressive, eh?
It's pretty impressive. And I'm not just talking about the aesthetics. I'm talking about the gang. The gang is all here.
Why,
every single one of them is here on with us. And
this booth looks like a gigantic one-piece booth, but we, as people were asking today, how do you carry that around? Well, after this, if the Ugly Pike guys want to do a podcast in Niagara somewhere, they got their little booth set up. They can do it now, so it's very convertible,
movable.
There's
Frank right there. I see Frank sitting right up front. Mr. Frankie. Is he eligible for the free giveaway? They can't. Did we put a disclaimer on that?
He's in the wrong chair.
He's in the wrong chair.
I'll tell you what. I'll give away
$100 is going away.
No, I'm going to give away our Prince Craft boat if somebody can jiu-jitsu Frank and Garo on the rugs here, on the carpets, on the floor right now.
Has to be done right in front of us.
Right here. My money's going to be on Frank, okay? Just to let you know.
Podcast Network highlights on fishingcanada.com. This particular issue is eating wild. I see Antonio and the boys are here too.
Yes, sir.
Hello, sir. How are you? Wonderful. Another gentleman just walked by the booth here.
Walking by. Saw your lovely face and said, hey.
And what is there not to love about that face, by the way?
Exactly.
Eating wild, they are. Oh,
they had a special guest. I guess that
you were the guest on that episode.
I was the guest.
Well, then do tell.
I'm not talking about it. I don't. You
episode 38. Eating wild is featured on the Outdoor Journal Radio Podcast Network article. I guess it would be. Or how do we?
We put all the podcasts up on the website.
We
It'll
just
be
put
on
them
the homepage.
Yep. On the whole dealio. And this one that you're highlighting is this particular episode that featured Mr. Bowman.
Peter Bowman.
Yes.
Oh my God. I have not listened to that.
It's worth a listen.
Really?
It's a good one.
It's probably very good.
I haven't listened to it either, to be honest with you.
Oh, that's nice.
No, I never know. You never know what to expect.
Anyways, I've got written right here in front of me. My instructions are to say that the question is why Pete chose TV over tournament fishing.
Oh,
whoa! Now I do have to.
Now
tune
you
in.
Want
I
to hear that, don't you? Especially you, of all people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And why canoes are hindering Antonio's duck hunting career.
Yeah.
Holy mackerel, it's going all the way.
We went
and,
in there.
And why metal can't be played around campfires.
We talked about that a little bit. Yeah.
You can't play metal music around campfires?
You can, but you'll probably lose your audience pretty quick.
Okay.
You know?
And for a made-for-TV shore lunch recipe. So how does a made-for-TV shore lunch recipe differ from a regular shore lunch recipe?
I guess you have to listen to the podcast
My
to
God,
find
now
out.
You got me hooked. I got it. And it's called Eating Wild, and it's on either Spotify or...
It's everywhere.
Wherever you consume your podcasts from, look it up. It's Outdoor Journal Radio Network. And Eating Wild is the episode that we're talking about right now. In the news, Mr. Bowman.
Oh, my God. One of my bucket listers, a state tiger trout record rescinded. So
yes.
An angler in Idaho named Cody King, by the way, not the Cody King that I know because I have a nephew named Cody King. Cody with a C. This is Cody with a K. Oh, just to let you know. Pretty cool.
Not related to Chris King.
Not at all related to Chris King. No, Chris is much more handsome than Cody, just to let you know. Huh. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's because you're
I like
afraid
to see
of him.
Them go after each other. Cody's pretty big. I like to see Kinger and him go.
Bigger than Kinger?
Oh, he's way bigger than Kinger, but holy I think Kinger might still take him.
He's
even at his age.
Kinger's cut.
Kinger's lean. He's looking good, isn't he?
Yeah,
Cody, this Cody King here from Idaho caught a 29-inch trout, a tiger trout, which, by the way, is a cross between a brook trout and a brown trout.
Right,
Dean?
Yeah, I believe so.
Yeah, such a cool, a cool looking fish. So he caught a while of fish in the Montpellier Reservoir.
Yep.
And King kept the trout with the impression he might have a new state record. The previous record was 4.8 pounds,
yes.
Held by another angler, I don't even have to say the name, and was easily surpassed the record in at 8.47 pounds. However, conservation officers later saw the image of the fish catch and immediately became suspicious. As the fish didn't be caught at nighttime. It seemed to be caught at nighttime. It was discovered late that King did not purchase a license beforehand, only having a one-day non-residence fishing license around 2 p.m. of the day when he claims he caught the fish. So he pushed the gauntlet a little bit. He fished later than he should have on a one-day license.
I feel kind of bad.
So just so I understand this. So the guy went out fishing without a license.
Let me have a little shot of espresso.
Go ahead,
so
Peter.
He had a license.
By the way, you did such a wonderful job of reading that.
So far.
He had a license the day before, and he overdid it.
He overrode his license?
He fished over his allotted time.
After midnight.
Yeah.
Okay,
after
so
midnight,
no, I'm just trying to think, though.
Nice
seriously, though, yes, he broke the law, but...
Don't.
No.
We
I'm
need
not
to
suggesting.
Condemn, not condone.
I do feel bad for him, though.
I do, too.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
The guy's... Probably, maybe he didn't even know that his license
expired. More than
expired.
Likely, we would take that for granted. That's probably what happened, I would
This
think.
Is not a guy who went out without a license, caught a new state record fish and said, oh my God, I got to go get a license. No.
Yeah.
That's what it sounded like at first.
And he went back and bought another one after.
Yeah, you know.
So, I don't know.
I mean, I'm not saying it's okay, but it's not as bad as I originally thought on this story.
And he had to write a public apology in the newspaper, and his license is suspended for a year.
Oh, my God.
It's a bit terrible. Heavy,
well, that's terrible.
Let's just say if he wouldn't have submitted, he'd have never got caught.
So what happened to his record? His record's still on record.
No.
It's rescinded.
They took it off.
No, but how can they do that?
It never was a record. It was just submitted as a record, but you broke the law, buddy. No, you didn't.
Wow.
You can't do that stuff.
That's pretty serious stuff.
Honest officer, I only had two beers.
And not only
well,
was
six
it...
six hours ago. I've got 20 in me now, but, you know.
Well, that's you. But
you know,
most of us are responsible
beer,
enough
buddy.
Not to do
I
that.
I cannot do that.
But what was remarkable about this is normally when a record is broken, you're talking a few ounces.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this was remarkable.
It.
Like, there may never be another 8.5-pound... a
tiger
record tiger ever again.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah.
That's because it's got to be done legally.
Wow.
Yeah. Okay.
All right.
Poor guy. Well, okay, Cody. We agree. We think that you didn't do that on purpose. We think you just... Well, actually, he did do it on purpose when he bought that second license. That shows your guilt. He went in, I better buy another license after the fact.
I suppose.
Right?
I suppose. Hey, and there's a young Stephen Nedzwicki standing
out
there, too.
Look at the pipes on that guy.
Is
Speaking
he
of looking
ever good,
good eh?
Yeah.
Look at that. Mount Everest on his arm there. Wow.
Dave from Ontario wants to know via the fan question. Now, this one is via email.
Yep.
That's what Dean was talking about.
So if you want to connect with us and have a question answered here on the program, what you need to do is reach out to us via email, info@fishingcanada.com,
yeah, I believe. Right.
And submit your question. Then Dean takes these things as they come in daily. And he puts them in his 45-gallon drum that he reclaimed from the dump. Nicely painted and all, got all the dents out of it.
Did he get Sean Kelly to supply him with
that? I think Sean might have helped him with that.
Okay.
And so he just prints them out and puts all of these questions in the drum. And then he pulls one out randomly and we read it here. It is not. It is not at all. Stop doing that.
You call him out, Dino. You call him out, buddy.
So Dave from Ontario wants to know, what do you do when you see a large cluster of fish suspended over 20 foot flat on the Garmin fish finder? Well, generally, the first thing that Pete and I do is high five each other. We say, finally, there they are.
He continues saying, I tried trolling through the right depth, or just above, with walleye divers, husky jerks, etc., and nothing. I've also tried spoons and spinner baits, as well as slip bobbers with small plastic grubs. No luck. I often catch the odd walleye and pike on some of the rock formations around in the same area. That's a great question. Looking for walleye. He's talking about walleye.
He mentions walleye, right? And also, I'm going to assume a 20-foot flat that these fish are suspended somewhere, you know, halfway down the water column.
That's what he says. Fish suspended over 20 foot.
Well, suspended could be just below the surface, could be suspended off the bottom, but let's assume that they're right in the middle of that water column. So 20 feet is not that deep anymore, by the way. You know, we used to think, when you look at 20 feet, sometimes you have to put it into perspective. And in our case, when we say, oh, that's 20 feet of water, the way we bring it into the real picture for us, we just look at the boat that we're standing on, because FNC1 or our Princecraft 200, it's 20 feet from nose to stern.
Step her up like that, right?
Just put her up on her end, and that's how deep of water. So all of a sudden, 20 feet doesn't seem like a whole lot of water anymore.
Right.
And there's a million different ways. I'm also going to make an assumption that he's tried all of his favorite, he's got them here, jerk baits, husky jerks, and walleye divers, etc., and nothing. And I'm also going to assume, he's even done the slip bobber thing.
Right.
Holy smoke.
Right.
The only thing I don't see here is, has he dived, tried trolling through them as well? Holy macro. I think we'd probably move.
Before you even start out,
right?
My question is, do you know what those fish are? You don't know their
walleye.
So we're assuming. You do not know their walleye.
We should not assume that he knows for sure.
Especially when they group up in a big group, large clusters, he says, in 20 foot, on a 20 foot flat, to be honest with you, the most times we see walleye, they'll be grouped up in three to five fish. Yeah. Here a group, there a group, everywhere. They're not grouped up in a giant school like that. So that's the first thing you got to remember is, are they a target species to begin with? You know what I mean? And if so, what are they? And then you go from there. But normally, these walleye, a lot of times, will not school in a large cluster over 20 feet. So they have to determine that first. How are you guys?
How you doing, guys?
After that, you know, you got a guy like Steve Bates, who's a walleye expert.
Oh,
and
look
he'll,
at him.
You know, and a good looking man at that, too.
He is a handsome package, wasn't he? Seriously.
Best dressed guy here, as usual.
I would think so.
So, once you hear that, you got to figure out if they're walleye
or
not.
Have a seat.
So.
You don't think we gave you all those compliments for nothing, do you?
That's awesome. So once you determine, I mean, you can't, the only way to determine that for sure, I mean, Garmin is great. Garmin is, to us, the best fish finders, but you can't tell what species of fish they are unless you drop a camera down. That's the only way you're going to be able to tell what they are. So, you know, to me, you're doing better by going to those rocks and hitting those as close to structures.
Let's try and isolate it just for 1 second. You know, if we were only going to do one of these things that he's mentioned he has done before, which one of those things would it be in our case?
I'd be trolling minnow, like Yozuri crystal minnow, and if they're not hitting that, I would just keep trolling. I'd draw two or three passes and go, and then I just keep going is what I do. Or Or I would cherry pick them with our live scope. I would try and cherry pick them with our live scope. I would put the, I would cast out just like the bass guys are doing. I'd take a nice little shad bait, cast it out, watch your bait just above their head and reel it really slow above their heads and just see if there's any interest. If there's any interest at all, you're going to catch whatever it is. If not, move on.
Are you as surprised as I am to find out that there are other people out there who have the wherewithal to think of putting a slip bobber on?
No, I love it.
I think it's fantastic.
It's a great idea. Great. As long as you're getting that above their heads. If they're not hitting that, move on too, right?
So. Absolutely. Hopefully something there, Dave, helped you out. I know we were pretty vague on it, but the problem is you covered everything that we would have thrown at you anyways, including the slip bobber.
Yeah.
So unfortunately, we don't have one answer for you. Just keep digging away, man. All righty.
Wardrobe change coming up.
That's right. We forgot.
We got to change for our guest because he's very special.
I forgot all about our special guest. Will be here very shortly.
We're like Cher and Beyonce. We got to do a wardrobe change between each set.
But we are going to take a quick break before we do that. More journal after this. Don't you dare go away. You do not want to miss our next guest. The humble goldfish, everyone's favorite aquatic pet. It's small, easy to care for. What's there not to love?
Even the cat may be mesmerized by the color and movements of your aquarium friends. Goldfish are great at home, but don't let them loose.
Releasing goldfish or other domestic aquatic pets or plants into natural environments is harmful to both your pet and the planet.
Goldfish disrupt ecosystems by outcompeting native species for food and resources in degraded habitats. They contribute to algae blooms, they kill aquatic wildlife, and pass viruses and diseases contracted in aquariums to wild fish.
They could even live up to 40 years and grow as big as a football. Anglers, this is where you come in. If you find a goldfish at your local fishing spot, report it to the invading species hotline or go online to eddmaps.com.
Remember to never dump your live bait into the water and risk spreading other aquatic invaders. Keep our lakes free from invaders and don't let them loose.
How did a small town sheet metal mechanic come to build one of Canada's most iconic fishing lodges? I'm your host, Steve Nidzwicki, and you'll find out about that and a whole lot more on the Outdoor Journal Radio Network's newest podcast, Diaries of a Lodge Owner. But this podcast will be more than that. Every week on Diaries of a Lodge Owner, I'm going to introduce you to a ton of great people, share their stories of our trials, tribulations, and inspirations. Learn and have plenty of laughs along the way.
Meanwhile, we're sitting there bobbing along, trying to figure out how to catch a bass. And we both decided one day we were going to be on television doing a fishing show.
My hands get sore a little bit when I'm reeling in all those bass in the summertime, but that's might be for more fishing than it was punching.
You so confidently you said, "Hey, Pat, have you ever eaten a drum?"
Find Diaries of a Lodge Owner now on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you get your podcast.
We interrupt this program to bring you the much-anticipated bonus code for the latest Fishing Canada giveaways. This week's code is Banana Boat. That is all caps and one word. B-A-N-A-N-A-B-O-A-T.
Oh, my.
Just type that in the bonus code section of the contest and receive 100 free entries towards all of our current giveaways. And for those of you who aren't entered yet, what are you waiting for? Head over to fishingcanada.com while you listen to the rest of this episode, click contest, and sign up for all the latest Fishing Canada giveaways. And now, back to the episode.
All right, the big moment we've been waiting for. We told you earlier on that we were thrilled. Probably the biggest guest we've ever had on Outdoor Journal podcast, although he has been on Outdoor Journal Radio a couple of times.
All right.
The Premier of Ontario, our good friend Doug Ford. Thank you for joining us, buddy.
I know, guys.
We're thrilled to death.
Let's hear it, Doug.
Thanks. You know, you say the biggest. He's talking physically.
No.
That's what he's talking about.
Well, I tell you what, Doug. Nobody has ever been a guest with that way. Said you can't announce it till 10 o'clock. Okay. Yeah. Usually we normally go. Just so you're big time, buddy.
Well, before we get started, yep. I I have to just say this because I don't know whether everybody is aware of it or not. There are two things. When the last time we had Mr. Ford on our show, there are two things he promised me and the anglers and the outdoors people.
Yeah.
Both of them he has kept. So I want to put a spotlight on it because not many people do. They always want to go to the negative side. We asked Mr. Ford 5 years ago if he could help us change a fishing regulation in terms of number of fishing rods that could be used to carp fish in the province of Ontario, because we were the only jurisdiction in the country that had this antiquated law in place. And we asked him to help us, and he promised that he would when he got elected, because this was prior to the election. Right. And he also promised something else on our live radio show. He said, I'll promise you this, the taxes for people and the businesses in this province will not be raised when I get into power. Yeah. And my friend, you have kept that was in spades.
Thank you. That carp thing that Ansa's talking about, we asked, this is how good Doug Ford is. We asked for two rod rule. He says, hell yeah, we'll do your three. So now you can fish a three rod rule out there. That's how good this guy is.
Well, no, you have to have the three rods in there.
Exactly.
Of course. What?
Yeah, and anyways, I just don't believe in taxes. We've never raised a tax on businesses or people, ever.
Perfect.
Do you think everybody knows that?
I don't know, but we have to get it out there because we're the only government in the history of this country that's never raised a tax, ever. We believe in raising revenue through growth, and we've seen growth, unprecedented growth in this province, in the business sector, economics, and along with the people.
Well, you certainly impressed us. So I hope everybody that's here listening live, I hope the folks who are picking this up on the podcast understand how important that is. It's certainly
especially these young people out there. Listen to this stuff. It's important.
These are our people. I love it.
Absolutely.
I love the anglers and hunters. I'm one of them.
We wanted to ask you that. Do you get time now that you're premier? Because last time I talked to you, you weren't. Now that you're premier, do you make time to get outdoors? Do you still enjoy the outdoors?
I
love outdoors. It's just a time of getting away for a day or two up to the cottage, and and a lot of events in the summer are held on the weekend. I love getting up there.
What's your favorite fish, Doug? What if you had to go fishing for something? What would be your favorite?
So we only had bass in our lake. It's a landlocked lake.
Yeah.
And then I guess someone dumped something in there, and they had pike. And then a small lake, the pike are eating the bass.
Yep.
I always say, keep the pike, throw the bass back in.
There you go.
Pike, though. Pike are pretty good, too.
I love the pike. I just don't like the pike eating the bass. That's it.
Speaking of eating, do you enjoy eating fish?
Well, then when I catch the bass, they're a little kind of mushy.
Have you tried pike?
Do a grill? Yeah, I've tried pike before. It's good.
Pike is really good. People don't realize how good it is.
It's good. Put a little butter on top of that, too.
Oh, yeah, buddy.
Not to put a downer on this conversation, but when you got into power at the beginning of your term, we had that ugly thing called the pandemic.
Yeah.
And we've been working through it with the tourism sector in this province because they were hit hard.
Yeah.
How is that coming along? How is that whole tourism
recovering?
Are we back?
I see a recovery in a big way. Everyone's coming into our province. A lot of tourism's coming into our province.
Yeah.
There's always still more things we can do to attract them, but we're trying everything we possibly can. We live in the greatest jurisdiction in the world, bar none.
Absolutely agree.
What people don't realize, we have 250,000 lakes. Think of that, 250,000 lakes.
That quarter mil.
We used to go to, I say used to because the program is over, but we used to go to England and represent Ontario at their shows like this, right?
Yep.
And the biggest, we used to have the big Ontario map behind us, and the biggest surprise when we talked to folks there, when we tell them we'd have over 200,000 lakes and they're all free to fish, they couldn't believe it.
That's right.
They may have one or two, and they have to pay for them.
Yeah.
That's right.
This is all free.
It's incredible.
It boggles the mind. Boggles the mind.
But what people don't know, we have 145 fish species as well. Think of that, 145 of them.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so and a lot of those are sport fish, game fish,
yeah,
right?
Absolutely.
So it's a great province for it. Yeah. How important is fishing and hunting in rural communities in Ontario? Yeah.
It's a way of life. It's a way of life.
It is.
It also attracts tourism.
Right.
Big time, and especially from the U.S. We love our American friends that come up and spend those greenbacks as much as they can.
Well, this is the last frontier for them, right?
That's right.
So they look at us as, oh my God, we're going up to the last part of the world where you can actually roll up your sleeves and get out there. And
if you think, we mentioned the 250,000 lakes, but there's 490,000 kilometers of rivers.
Right.
That you can fish in.
Right.
That's,
and there's
that's,
ponds too.
Yeah.
The best part about, like, when people don't realize, is Northwest Ontario is bordered by the U.S. in God's country, basically, and all that beautiful
that's
fishing.
Right.
And there's so much tourism for most people going over the border, International Falls, et cetera, et cetera. So it's important for sure, right?
People don't realize, and I didn't even realize until I became premier, and you fly around this province and You're getting as far east as Kenora, and then they tell you there's another 800 kilometers north.
Exactly.
Put it into perspective, we're larger than California and Texas combined.
Yeah.
Dude, it's massive. One of our ridings, electoral ridings, is the size of France.
Wow.
So, yeah, it's pretty incredible.
That's a pretty cool stat. I like that.
Never even heard of that before. That's fantastic. So one of the things we wanted to talk to you about, we have another good friend in your government, Thibault.
Oh, yeah.
Who is, he used to be Minister of Tourism and now is in mental health.
Yeah,
and we talk to him often about the importance of the outdoors and this community in terms of mental health, too. It's such a big thing. Sometimes
that's
we forget just how big it is.
So, Michael Thibault is a great minister. He's he travels everywhere. I don't know how he clogs the
mind. He's hardcore.
He is everywhere. You know, preaching the gospel, as we say. And we've invested $3.8 billion. And we've never had a minister of mental health and addiction. I put him hand in hand ever in this province.
Yeah.
I think we're the only ones in the country. Maybe a couple others have hopped on board. But it's great. And you know, to get away from the stress and everything that people feel, the anxiety. There's nothing better than going up north, grabbing a reel, and throwing it in the water.
It's the best. It's the best.
An interesting study that we keyed in on a few years ago, I think it was in Wisconsin. The university there did some studies with mental health, but in particular with kids that had, that what we call I mean, there's a variety of different names for it, but, kids who were hyper.
Yeah.
And they found that if they spent time in green spaces, that they could actually start reducing the dose of drugs that they were on.
It was credited to outdoors.
Agree.
I'm not an expert in this, but I'd agree.
You get them
outdoors, they're enjoying it. And they have a lot of camps for kids with special needs.
Right.
Out there.
And a lot of these camps have fishing as well.
Absolutely.
I mean, camping and fishing and hiking, et cetera, right?
Oh,
it's all part
and
parcel.
I got to give a shout out to Tim Hortons. They have great camps
for
kids with special needs.
Yeah, absolutely.
What a great job they do. That was a good plug, by the way. Also, want to remind folks that are listening or maybe here today, sometimes I was talking to a couple of people here earlier on today, and I was asking them, they're in their mid-40s,
Youngins, a couple of youngins, right?
And asking them how often they take their kids. They had two kids with them. How often they go out fishing and stuff. And they said, well, are you kidding me? Every weekend, every possible weekend. And that got me to thinking, because there's so many people that we talk to, and I'm sure you do as well, that don't make the time for that. To take the opportunity, use fishing, use whatever you want to use as a platform. Use it just to get kids out into that space.
That's right.
It's so important.
It is. So what we've done in partnership, and we're through a little construction up north, so we haven't been able to do it the last couple of years, but we're going to resume this with a cooperation with 23 Division, Ron Tavner, superintendent up there. By the way, longest serving police officer in North America.
What? Nice.
Yeah, he's, what is he, 56 years on the job. He's 76.
Cool.
He's incredible. So anyways, we go up into high priority neighborhoods in Rexdale, and these kids have never been up north. They've never put their foot in the lake before. when I talked to some of the parents, get the permission slips, they didn't know where Muskoka was. So we get a busload, about 80 kids, we bring them up to the cottage, and we get them on the jet ski, on inner tubes. And,
oh, boy, there's nothing like that just, for them, eh?
It was the best part of the year, they say.
Yeah, it's a shame. It's a shame.
Cooking burgers, and we need to do more of that.
Yeah, a lot more.
And you know what? The heart, I think, to me, I can live this life. I've lived this life right now. My boys, they came out, they love the outdoors big time with hiking, with fishing, etc. But there's a time when they get that late teens, at 19 or 20, 21, where they start to get away from that. They don't want to even go outdoors in that. So that's the one we have to, and then they transition to, again, later on, they go back into it. Maybe that's just a natural way. It's what happened to me, too. But it'd be nice to get all, constant, those 19, 20, 18, 19, 20-year-olds staying involved in the outdoors. So that's what we got to work on next, for sure.
No, it's absolutely a tough one, but we got to get these boys to bring their girlfriends up. They have a good time.
Yeah.
They go fishing, campfires.
That's it.
That's what it's all about.
All about the girlfriends.
We've seen all kinds of that out here, for sure.
Yeah, for sure.
What's the big buzz out there right now in your life in terms of politics? What's the next hurdle that you're working on?
It comes at you like a machine gun. It's pretty well everything. But then the main thing right now, anywhere, is affordability.
Yeah.
Making sure we have affordable homes, affordable groceries, and affordable gas. I'm not going to be political, but I have no choice. The carbon tax... They're raising it again on April the 1st. They've lost their minds.
Yeah, yeah.
No, they're going to get annihilated. You can't, right now, you see the gas companies playing games. What was last week? It was $1.33. Now it's jumping $1.50.
Yeah. Why?
Like, it's nuts.
It's called a monopoly when you have five companies controlling all the fuel in our country.
Right.
But eventually that's gonna change.
You know, I'm glad you brought that up. I don't want to get political, but I might as well. It's not very often I get this this opportunity. But how can they push a tax through, like carbon tax?
Yeah, well, when clearly
people don't want it.
But they're increasing it by 23%. And the number one issue, and I've been pounding them on it, I've talked to them personally, telling them, you guys are going to get annihilated. You do this.
Well, yeah.
And it's their ideology. They're taking more money out of people's pockets. Everything runs on energy. Inflation causes 30% of our inflation is through energy cost and gas. Because every product that gets shipped out on fuel.
Yeah. Everything. It touches everything.
Your home heating bills, everything, companies, you name it.
Yeah.
So we're going to pay the price.
I like that. He says they're going to get annihilated. I love it.
They are going to be made up. But I have told them personally, face to face, I can't believe you're doing this in a time that people are finding very hard to afford their bills and their food and their gas.
Yeah.
And trying to buy a home now, these interest rates at 5% are killing people.
Yeah.
And just imagine when people renew them in a year or 2 years, it's going to be a lot of problems unless they drop these interest rates below 4%. The Bank of Canada, they're antiquated, and they're living back in the 1970s. It's terrible.
It's almost as if they're not listening.
Oh, they aren't listening.
Yeah. They're not. It's even tough, for this crowd right here to grab your boat. Let's say you got a boat, motor trailer, and your truck, and you want to go fishing an hour or 2 hours away. It's an expensive day.
Oh, is it ever?
It's ridiculous.
is it ever?
All you want to do is go and live a great life and have some fun. So,
yeah.
It's stupid.
Finally, I just wanted to give you kudos on something I didn't know. I found out just the other day when I knew you were coming on. Did I hear correctly that Ontario is the leader globally on EVA batteries, the manufacturing?
Yeah,
is this true?
Yeah, it is. So Bloomberg just came out with those headlines, which is pretty impressive that they ranked on Ontario. They said Canada, but it's Ontario is the place. The number one EV battery and assembly facility anywhere in the world.
Really?
We're the only jurisdiction in the entire world that have six of the largest auto manufacturers right here. And it all starts up with the critical minerals. We're finally going to get the road to the Ring of Fire moving.
Are we?
Yeah, we are. It's a lot of the feds are blocking it, which again I don't understand, because everything has cell phones, computers, everything has a critical mineral in it.
Right.
We are the mining capital of the world. We had the convention. It's called PDAC. 300 countries showed up. It was everyone wants our critical minerals. That's fine. They can have it as long as they produce the products here. They aren't taking our critical minerals over to wherever and producing a battery and shipping it back.
Right.
They're going to be manufactured here, which they are. I went down to the Stellantis plant, and I've never seen a plant that big. It's 4.2 million square feet.
Where's this?
That's in Windsor. In Windsor. Windsor, Essex. Okay.
Wow.
And then St. Thomas, if you think 4.2 million, then you go to St. Thomas, you have Volkswagen that's building the fourth largest building in the world, the largest battery plant in North America, 16 million square feet.
Oh, my God.
So it's 1.6 kilometers long.
It's as
by
big
a kilometer
as Oshawa.
Deep. Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's huge. It's absolutely huge. But that creates good-paying jobs for people.
Yeah,
for
sure.
That's going to create direct and indirect 30,000 jobs just in that area.
Yeah. Fantastic.
And, so we have a few more announcements. We've seen $28 billion invested in the EV sector last couple of years. And then this year, hopefully, we'll set another record, $30 billion. But I give all the credit to our great guy, Vic Fedeli. He's a North Bay guy.
I love him to death.
He is. He's
Vic,
the best.
Vic and I go way back.
Number one salesperson, travels around the world.
Yeah.
I don't know how the poor bugger does it. He must put on two million miles a year, literally. But he's our number one.
Vic's good.
Great
he's
guy.
Good.
First met him when he was the mayor of North Bay years ago. He's fantastic.
We have Rick Breezy right around here. Yep. There he is.
Yep.
Dave Smitty. And Deepak and on, wherever Deepak, there he is.
There
you can't
he is.
Miss him.
Nice.
Right beside Holly over there, the champ.
The
great
champ.
Guys. What
the
a
champ.
Crew.
I love it.
And I'm glad you pointed them out because in as much as you are spearheading everything and you're the face of this government, I just do want to point out, knowing a few of them personally, that you have got an incredible team.
Yeah.
The best
and
team.
I envy you, man.
So our family's been in politics about 35 years. I've never seen a team assemble. I'm not just saying it.
No,
because this
true.
Team is better than the previous team in 2018. Yeah. The best team I've ever seen in politics, ever. And the reason we're the best team in politics, because we aren't into being a politician.
Right on.
We're common folk. We're,
nice.
We're business people, business minded. And the last thing I like is the politicians. We have a great team because they aren't politicians.
As well said. I like that.
All we got to do now is get some of them out in the water.
Oh, yeah. Oh, they're all up. We're up in both areas. Something in God's country.
Absolutely. We got to get out of the water. Premier, I can't tell you how honored and thrilled we are to have you on the show in front of a live audience. That's like right out of the park for us. So we're thrilled to death. I know everybody here at the show. Once they saw you were in the building, it was like a rock star coming in here.
One day,
I'm the average guy.
One day, Doug, he and I want to get all those cameras following us around like you
exactly.
got.
Exactly.
Yeah, no, that's what we're going to aspire to, bud.
But there was one guy that loved this show more than I did, and that was my brother, Rob.
Oh,
he used to love bringing the kids over to the little trout pond. And, he would do anything to get up north and go fishing, and he absolutely loved it.
He's got to be thrilled to death. Watching, looking down, and
from above,
and
yeah.
seeing your success that you've had in politics—it's got to be a thrill to him.
To go to root cause, I wouldn't be premier if it wasn't for Rob.
Yeah,
and that's
sure.
the truth
yeah,
of the
right.
matter.
Yeah,
for sure.
Yeah. Man.
So
well
he loved fishing more than anyone.
My friend,
thank you.
Thank you so much.
Appreciate
really appreciate it,
gentlemen. Thank you so much.
Big round of applause for your premier, Doug Ford.
Thank you.
Thank you, Doug.